So, a couple years ago when I came to the Ohio State University for graduate school, I was really interested in Italian men about colony collapse disorder affecting these, and all my work is sort of environmental in nature and sort of, political in nature, you could say. And so in researching this, you know, I began talking to one of the undergrads there, Dan Jarvis, and he was really interested in bees and had worked at the bee extension and was basically a master beekeeper. He was saying he wanted to keep bees, but he didn't have a place to do it. And as a grad student, I knew I could get permission to do it there. So it was sort of like, well, maybe I should make art with bees. That would be really interesting. And so it literally was like 2 years of research to figure out how to make them do this. And it was just a matter of like watching them and putting different objects in the hive and seeing how they reacted. There was a lot of failure. There was a lot of things that they just weren't interested in. And then Dan's mother became sick and he had to move back home. And so that kind of became a game changer for me, because up until then I'd sort of been like the parent that got to go in and like play with the kids, you know, like a divorced parent and someone else did all the work. And once I had to do the work, I started noticing a lot more about their behaviors. Like, there was a piece of duct tape that had accidentally sort of gotten stuck in. It was on the outside of the hive, and they started chewing it up. And I was like, "Well, that's really interesting." So I started putting paper and fabric in so they could chew it. And then I started noticing how they glued everything down with propolis, which is this yellow goo that's on the fabric. You know, it's like bee goo basically that they make out of resin from trees, you know, tree sap. And it has these kind of magical antibiotic properties. They think it can cure cancer, and it has all these like, you know, different health properties. So I just started getting really interested in like all their processes and everything they did. And of course, the comb is so beautiful. And so there were other artists that I was aware of that were working with bees. There's an artist named Agnetha Dyke, who's Canadian, and she does, you know, she'll put like little tchotchke objects, you know, like little figurines into the hive and have them be like build on it. There's another artist who builds these sort of programmed hives where like the whole hive becomes a work of art. And so I didn't want to repeat what they were doing, and I was trying to sort of find my own voice with it. And then in frustration at one point, I was like not getting any of the results I wanted. So in frustration, I just kind of took a piece of the foundation that we used to put in the frames. So it's basically a flat sheet of wax that's embossed. And I just crumpled it up and kind of threw it in there to see what would happen. And this is what happened. And I was like, oh, wow, I can exploit that. So I started playing with, you know, different ways that I could like build a sculpture. So I mean, this is a one that I think most looks like what it started as, maybe, where I like had this loop over here and built these very formal, very almost modernist kind of shapes. And they actually grow in the hive like this. So this was tied to a stick and the form was coming off of it, and then they built it this way. And there's this sort of trick of like getting it at just the right moment before they get attached to it, and they start laying eggs in it and putting nectar in it. So there's places where it's like I have to cut parts away because it's got nectar in it, or because they've connected it to something else. And then, you know, so it's really, I sort of see it as a real collaboration. And I know there's like some of my professors argue with me a lot about that a lot, but I feel like I'm proposing a form to the bees, and the bees then are either accepting or rejecting it and turning it into something. And then I get it back and basically finish up the process of turning it into a sculpture. So the paintings, you know, which I sort of call paintings even though they're not, I think of them as like trace paintings, just traces of like action that has happened. And so in each of them, like the one that's the yellowest was in the hive for the longest. And in each of them, I sort of put wax where I wanted them to do something, and then everything else was the bee's decision. So like in this one, they're just angry that it's in there, and they're chewing it up and trying to take it out, and they'll be flying away from the hive with little tiny strings, you know? And then I sort of love the poesis, that what they're doing is destroying the work of another insect, because that's silk. So that was made by silkworms, and then they're taking it apart. And there's several objects in here where, like, the wood is stuff that was manipulated by insects also. There's spalted maple that leaves a trail in it where the insects travel. And there's some cherry over here that's been chewed by some sort of beetle or something. And then the bases, these brick pedestals were made at the Belden Brick Factory in the Amish country here in Sugar Creek, Ohio. And they're these bricks are like in every building in Ohio. I mean, Belden is like the biggest brick factory in the United States, and once a year they let Ohio State grads go up and sort of take over the place for the weekend. And one of the buildings alone is 10 acres. And they give us pallets of clay, and they give us, you know, bricks and whatever we need. And so these were made with these brick molds. There's anywhere from like 10 to 100 years old. They're all these old wooden brick molds, and they're parts of buildings, basically. So I sort of saw this as like, this is the bee's home. So it's essentially architecture. So sort of pairing it with the human architecture, you know, creating this relationship between the two things. And yeah, that's what I got to say. Anyone has questions?
How long does it take for the bees to make architecture?
It takes about a week, but it depends on what they're doing. So if nectar flow is really good and they're busy pulling nectar, it happens slower. And if they're, you know, like, it's just different cycles in what the bees are doing. So it takes about a week, and it's really important to watch it carefully and take it out before they start doing stuff with it, you know, because it's really meant for something else. And then by channeling their production into wax, I'm really sort of disrupting the cycle of them making honey, which is what they should be doing. So I'm, in essence, being a really bad beekeeper, you know, and just getting a different product from them. They really hated glass, and I had made these glass icebergs as one of the very first things, and I put wax on the inside thinking, you know, they'll build comb on the inside, and they just rejected it for the longest time. So finally we took a piece of comb that had brood in it and just stuck it in there, and then they won't abandon the brood. So they took care of it and they glued it down, but then they abandoned it after the brood hatched. So they're not a fan of felt here. Tear it up.
So what about the like very small bees? Like when there's such a difference between, you know, how much they build on that.
Yeah.
It's, like when you took it out, was it just that nothing was happening, or was it that they start doing something else with it? Like,
it's just an aesthetic decision on my part, because I really wanted to focus it out on the board of bees. I copper plated some dead bees and I put those in there with them. And they actually like pulled the wings off and like ate the wings off. So I was sort of getting concerned that like the bees themselves wouldn't make dead bees disappear. So, because that's what they do, they take the dead bees out. So I felt like I needed to go rescue it with that one. You know, like if I left there too much longer, there'd be no bees left, you know. They're aggressive with the cleanup. And then the ones that are written in, that was actually the initial thing that I wanted to do. Is my initial idea of working with the bees, which didn't ever really wind up happening, was, you know, there were all these theories behind colony collapse disorder that were conflicting, and I wanted to have the bees sort of illustrate these theories of their demise, you know, and I thought it was this poetic idea, but I would try, like, first I tried, like, sticking down wax onto it, and then they rejected that, and then it took about three tries of doing it this way, where all I really did is burn into the cone and melt the words into it, and then they go in and repair it. But the first time, I didn't get it in time, and I laid brooding. And the second time, the wax was exactly the same color you can see it. So it just took a bunch of tries to make that happen. I think they're pretty satisfying, though. Like, I really like the fact that there's a word in it, you know. And it was a really hard thing to figure out the right words, too. You know.
So how did you design to do this?
You know, the We're Sorry one was like a totally spontaneous thing. Like, we had, it was when I was still working with my beekeeper, and we, he had accidentally killed one of the hives, and I'd gotten all this, like, but he'd accidentally killed the queen, and I'd gotten all this very dramatic footage of the bees dying on top of the hive, and I was really sad, so I went in and I was like, "We're sorry." You know, and then a lot of people were like, "Well, are the bees sorry, or are you sorry?" And then when I started getting stung, I found out I was allergic. But that's the important thing I left out. Yeah, terribly allergic now. Very sad. So when I started getting stung about it, I thought it was like the bees saying sorry to me also. So it's really a shame, you know. Everyone's sorry. We're all sorry.
I figured that out late.
I wish I figured it out earlier. But you know those weird candles that are just rolled up beeswax, you know, like the, I just use that wax, and the color, it went on there in a square, and then it just sort of, they diffused it through the piece in that way where it was almost stained. It's really beautiful. And that's kind of the direction I want to go with this, is like a lot more color and bigger. I've been thinking of ways that I could like do this in like a larger way by folding and manipulating the fabric between multiple frames. And, you know, it's difficult now because I have to find beekeepers to work with because I'm not going to be able to care for the hives myself. And I'm trying to sell my hives right now. So if anyone wants to be a beekeeper, it's awesome, I will say. I really enjoyed it a lot. It was fun, but the results from the sting is not fun at all.
Were these pieces hanging like that in the hive?
So, this was folded kind of in the center over a frame similar to that.
Oh, got it.
And then stapled down. And so I put wax where I sort of wanted something to happen. And then they just destroyed it. They just wanted to get rid of it. And that one literally happened in like 2 weeks they did that, which worked. You know, they hated the silk. And these, they really only picked at the edges. They couldn't get into it as much for whatever reason, synthetic fabrics. So, and then that one over there came on super early because the show was happening, basically. So, you know, I couldn't leave it as long, but then I also was like really happy with that yellow and how that yellow was just concentrating out once more.
Yes.
Were you doing the sculptures all year round or mostly in like the high activity summertime?
They're only in the summer and spring, so it's like I really have a short window of when I can work with them because there's only a certain amount of time they're building wax. I have things in the hive right now, but they're ignoring basically because they're sort of dying for the season. They're like busy with other things. So, and writing for the winter and stuff. So, really, I sort of need to get myself to California or Georgia or one of these places that's like year round beekeeping and find beekeepers there to work with. And I'm hoping I can sort of do it through shipping things back and forth, which is going to be really interesting to try to do. You know, yeah, it's going to be tricky, but I think if I, you know, use hive bodies, you know, the hive is in sections, it's in squares, so I'm figuring if I use them and I build the things into them so that it doesn't have, so that it's stable when they're building it, and then it's stable, like, when it gets shipped back, and just sort of, you know, plywood on each side and ship it like crazy. So, hopefully, we'll see. It may work, it may not, you know, it's hard to say. Keep going though. I just really want to keep working with them, and if I can't do it myself, I just need to find helpers. You know?
So if you put those back to the hive, are they going to continue building?
If I put them back to the hive, they're going to lay eggs, and then they're going to have a cycle of that. So yeah, they'll lay eggs, and then they'll fill it with honey, which also could look really cool. You know, I never let them do that, but.
Yeah, I wonder if we can let them deal with it when they're
I would like to, yeah. I wanted to have like a webcam in there that was like recording everything that was going on, but I just never got it. It's gonna be like infrared, and I just never got around to it. You know, someday I guess I can do that. Any more questions? All right. Thanks.
Thank you.